soft matters. Talking physics, talking life.
Today on the Physics Factor, I have the pleasure of interviewing Professor Larry Bonassar here at Cornell. And Larry, you're not actually a physics professor, are you?
I'm not, so I'm a professor of biomedical engineering and mechanical and aerospace engineering.
Okay, so related to physics.
Yes.
And I'm actually kind of curious how physics influences your work. What role does physics play in the research that you're interested in?
Sure. So my lab spends a lot of time thinking about the physics of cartilage, the mechanics of cartilage. So cartilage is this very primitive connective tissue that's found all over our bodies.
It's like on the end of your nose,
It's on the
right?
end of your nose, it's in your ears, it's in your windpipe.
Oh, I didn't know that one.
in the spine, it's the flexible motion segments of your spine, mm-hmm. and it's in all your joints. It's one of the things that allows your joints to move freely and without much friction.
Friction's a good physics word.
Friction is a great physics word. And in fact, this is something that my lab started doing maybe about a decade ago, and cartilage friction has become one of the really more prominent areas of investigation in the lab.
And I think what you're most known for, at least according to your group website, you have a beautiful a demonstration of the ear, the 3D printing that
sure.
you do, where you're printing an ear out of living cells, is that correct?
That's right.
And I'm kind of curious how you got interested in that particular research project. I know your background is in materials science.
Right.
I think there's also some biomedical background as well.
Right.
So did you come at it more from this 3D printing engineering side, or more from interest in biomedicine, or both just kind of came together in your head and you're like, aha?
Yeah, and it was more the latter, right? It was more kind of this was a real kind of condensation, if you will, of a whole bunch of different areas of my knowledge. As you said, my PhD is in material science, mm-hmm. and from there I did a postdoc in a hospital, Massachusetts General Hospital.
Okay.
And in a lab that was focused on cartilage cell biology, chondrocyte biology.
Okay.
And so in many ways, these tissue engineering studies are an intersection of how to use materials and cells together to try to regrow tissues.
And what are some of the things you have to think about if you're printing with a cell versus,
right.
apart from keeping it alive?
Right. Well, but that's a big one, right? So keeping it alive is a real challenge, right? Mm-hmm. So if you think about this idea of printing, mm-hmm. What makes a material printable is some combination of critical values of viscosity of the fluid that you're printing and surface tension. The analogy I use is if you can't print with water, right? Because the viscosity is too low and the surface tension is not high enough. So you print with water and it spreads on a surface, mm-hmm. right? And so you also can't print with marbles, right? You deposit the marbles and the marbles roll relative to each other.
Right, and they don't really gel together.
And they don't stick together, right. That's right. So you need sticky marbles, or you need really thick water, or you need something that's at the intersection between sticky marbles and thick water.
Okay.
Right? So there's the whole physics of printability, which is really interesting by itself. Mm-hmm. And then you have this other set of constraints, meaning that everything you have to print with, inside that droplet are cells, now both the chemistry and the physics of that material have to be compatible with things being alive, mm-hmm. right? My group really spends a lot of time thinking, you know, not about the kind of electronics or robotics aspects of printing, but really, if you will, the designing of the inks. Mm-hmm. We spend a lot of our time thinking about the development of living inks for printing living tissues,
okay.
right? What materials can we use? What cells can we use? Mm-hmm. Once we have that, how can we put cells and materials together to make tissues that kind of mimic the structure and function of native tissues.
Okay, so the ears that you guys have printed, for example, are those cells like the same sorts of cells that I would find in my ear?
They are. So the experiments that we've done actually start out with cow ear cells.
Okay.
This is actually relatively easier to get cow ear cells, harder to get human ear cells. Mm-hmm. Although we actually do have experiments in the lab going on right now that are using human ear cells.
That's
we get tissue shipped up from our medical school. Mm-hmm. We isolate the cells from that human ear tissue, and we have human ear cells growing in the lab kind of as we speak.
So apart from research, what sorts mm-hmm. of things do you like to do when you're not thinking about the human ear or 3D printing?
So, you know, I have three small kids. I have twin daughters who are 8 and a son who's 6. Mm-hmm. And so they occupy a lot of my free time, and that's great. So we spend a lot of time doing things like going to Little League games and going to swimming lessons and that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Mostly this time of year, I've gotten into gardening a lot lately, and that's also been a great...
Very nice outside for gardening.
It's beautiful for gardening. And it's actually not all that different than tissue engineering. It requires a lot of patience. It requires kind of a lot of planning and watching things change over time and mature over time. So it's also been a great activity with the kids, too. It's a great chance for science lessons, not so much in the physics lessons, more biology lessons. But it's been great. I really, that's kind of what relaxes me, what I spend my free time doing mostly during the summer.
And that actually makes me think back to the 3D printing. Have you played around with plant tissue or plant cells at all in terms of?
I never have. You know, it's something that the technology is so new and the area is so new that these things are all kind of cropping up.
Okay.
So plant tissue is something that I've heard proposed. My lab certainly doesn't do any of it.
Okay.
The physical infrastructure and the knowledge infrastructure for plant cell culture and mammalian cell culture are very, very different. So I know practically nothing about how to culture plants.
From the little I remember about biology, I know that animal cells and plant cells are very different
Very different, that's right.
Yeah.
But certainly this kind of technology has really interesting possibilities for basic science, both on the mammalian cell biology side and on the plant cell biology side.
Well, thank you so much, Larry.
Thank you.
It's been really fun.
Great. Thanks so much. So she used to be a news correspondent for MTV. Like,
whoa.
I remember her when I was in college. She was doing the MTV news.
Okay.
So the whole time during this interview, I'm having this flashback of her saying, hey, this is Serena. You know, Green Day is going to be on tour. But I was really struck. So we were having a conversation. We were just kind of talking, and then mm-hmm. and then the camera rolled, and like the smile, like just went, like exactly.
Yeah.
Yes. I was like, wow, that's a quantum. Like, I don't know if I can do that.